This episode of Juiced is bursting with goodness. We're stepping back in time to the land of the dinosaurs, getting our groove on with the Beats Bus, checking out Antman, one of the latest movies to hit the big screen. Plus, science is about to get glittery and gooey with Professor Jellybean. And Carlie Sparkle is back with another crafty way to recycle.
On Antman, but for now, let's head to the museum for our dinosaur discovery. We're here at Dinosaur Discovery Day, and look what we just found, something very strange.
The Leelanosaurus.
What's so special about these awesome animals?
They're from Australia and they were around 110 million years ago.
Welcome to Juiced TV, Scott. Thank you for coming.
My pleasure, Sarah. It's great to be here.
What is your favourite animal? Dinosaur, sorry.
Well, dinosaurs are animals. I have lots of favourites. But the coolest dinosaur, I reckon, is one called Australovenator. Means southern hunter. Australo means southern, venator is hunter. And I actually found one of the bones of Australovenator in 2006. And it was a finger bone of a meat-eating dinosaur. And had lots of teeth. It was a very cool animal. So yeah, that's my favourite.
What is your favourite part of your job?
Favourite part of my job? Well, finding fossils is obviously one of the best. Finding dinosaurs out in the west is really cool too. But you know what? The best part of my job is to actually tell everyone about the dinosaurs and to see the eyes of kids like yourself going in and seeing these dinosaurs for the first time. Really, really cool.
Harrison, how did you become a paleontologist?
Well, I loved paleontology when I was your age. I loved dinosaurs, I loved fossils. I started volunteering right here at the Queensland Museum when I was 12 years old. And then over the many years, I studied paleontology and went into university, got a degree, and then I became a paleontologist here at the museum. So it was a long period of study, but what was really cool is I got to get out in the field and find my own fossils, find dinosaur bones, find megafauna bones. It was really cool.
What was the most best meat Velociraptor?
The most favourite meat a Velociraptor could eat? I don't know, I wasn't around at the time, so I wouldn't know. In Jurassic Park, it was humans, wasn't it? But in the dinosaur world, it would have been small dinosaurs, probably about your height.
I think it's a Protoceratops.
It could be a Protoceratops, that's right. They lived at the same time, but there was all lots of little tiny dinosaurs that it could have chowed down on as well. So either way, if you were there at the time, you wouldn't want to be hanging around with a Velociraptor, I can tell you that.
Do you know when the country is actually split apart?
Yes, that's a really cool question. It's basically back in the past, back 100 million years or so ago, Australia was actually attached to Antarctica, Antarctica to South America to Africa, and India and all these places, and we call it Gondwana.
So everything touched together.
That's right, everything was attached together, and then over time it split apart. It was very cool.
Because
and that's
of an asteroid?
No, just because of underneath the surface of the Earth, underneath that crust is full of molten lava and magma, and it pushes and pulls.
So kind of like an earthquake.
That's exactly what happens when earthquakes go, and when you have volcanoes and earthquakes, that's the Earth moving. That's the crust moving. So every time there's an earthquake, it moves just a slightly little bit. You imagine over millions of years, those slight little bits turn into meters, kilometers, hundreds of kilometers, and that's how the Earth changes over time.
I have one more question, actually. How many dinosaurs do you think were around back then?
Yeah, that's a very good question. How many dinosaurs do we know of at the moment? There's probably over 1,500 species, so 1,500 species, but that won't be anywhere near as many as there were. But the fossils give us an indication of a very small number of dinosaurs, but you could imagine doubling or tripling it, so there might have been 3,000 or 4,000 different species. And they lived over 150 million years of time. So you can imagine how many different species of dinosaurs there would have been. Heaps.
What's the oldest dinosaur?
A dinosaur could live up to, it could actually be really old. Some could grow up to, you know, 100 and 150 years old. But we don't really know how old they got because all we have are their bones. There are some ways of looking inside the bones to figure out how long they've been living. But yeah, we sort of estimate, because if you look at turtles and lizards and crocodiles today, they can grow very old. Like crocodiles can grow up to 120 years old. So dinosaurs probably did the same sort of thing.
What is the biggest dinosaur bone in the world?
The biggest dinosaur bone in the world is actually probably Antarctosaurus. It's a thigh bone, and it's nearly 3 meters long. Can you imagine that? So as tall as some of the tallest people on Earth. Just one bone, that's the thigh bone from the knee to the pelvis.
Is any dinosaur big as a building?
Yeah, there are plenty of dinosaurs that are as long as a building, maybe as high as a building, but not as wide. You know, imagine some of these dinosaurs could grow up to 30 metres long or up to 5 or 10 metres tall, but they were still quite narrow. So, sure, they'd be as big as, they're certainly as big as cars. Some like a Triceratops was as big as a car.
There are lots of different ways to, everyone thinks dinosaurs died out. What do you think?
Well, there's a number of different ways where dinosaurs might have gone extinct. We know that not all dinosaurs actually went extinct, and there's some still living today, and they're called birds. So birds are descended from dinosaurs. So not all dinosaurs went extinct, but one thing we do know that happened 65 million years ago is a huge meteor, a huge asteroid, smashed into the Earth 65 million years ago. And it would have created a lot of dust, a lot of fires, changed the climate, and that would have caused a lot of problems. So the dinosaurs would have gone extinct because of that.
Thank you so much for talking to us at Disney TV, Scott.
My pleasure, Sarah. See you next time.
Thanks.
I love the T-Rex because it eats raptors and other animals.
Hi, my name's Lola, and my favourite dinosaur was the Therizinosaur.
Hi, my name's Imani. My favourite dinosaur was the Dinosuchus.
Okay, guys, it's time for our quick questions, but with a twist!
Yes, it's time to play Perfect Siblings, the game where we find out how well our two stars know each other. Let's hear it for Alana and her big brother, Kyle.
Alana is 8 and she has a birthday in August.
I'm 8 years old. My birthday is on the 28th of August.
Alana's favourite sport would probably be ballet and jazz.
My favourite sport is soccer.
Oh, this is a hard one. Her favourite movie character would probably be Joy out of Inside Out.
My favourite movie character... Rapunzel.
Her favourite animal is probably a cat, because we've got one.
My favourite animal is... a husky.
I think one of Alana's most embarrassing moments would be when she slipped over at Ice World and got her bottom all wet.
When I was about to kick a goal in soccer, I slipped over and then I kicked the ball on my nose and it hurt.
Her favourite food is probably broccoli and chocolate.
Mango.
Would Alana rather lick her nose or pick her toes? I think she'd probably pick lick her toes because she licks them at home.
Oh. They're salty.
Lick my toes.
She would probably go to Disneyland in America because she just really likes Disneyland.
I have to say, Texas in America, because then I get to see my brother's best friend, Caleb.
Alana's favourite song would maybe be Take Me to Church from Hozier.
My favourite song is Uptown Funk. Tonight we in the spot, don't believe and just watch. Ow!
Oh, her best dance move would probably be her doing the sprinkler, where she, yeah, but you sort of go like... I'm not very good at it.
A pirouette following on the splits.
All right, it's time to announce the final score for Perfect Siblings. And Kyle got... 2.
How could you? I'll get you out of it!
What should the punishment be? This is the perfect thing. When I'm moving into a new house, you have to buy me my house. No, just kidding. You have to buy me a Zuma puppy.
Okay, great.
Anyways, guys, it's time for some musical fun with the Beats Bus.
Woohoo! Annapurna draws a march!
Hi, my name is Laura, and this is Jace TV, and we're on the party deck. This is Brandon from Beats Bus.
Hi, everyone. Thanks, Laura. Thanks for having me.
What's Beats Bus?
So the Beats Bus, or Beats Bus Productions, as they're called, is a children's music group, and we do a whole different host of workshops and performances where we travel to schools, kindergartens, and work with children right through from ages 2 or 3 to, you know, 13, 15.
That's really cool. What inspired you to do music?
Oh, that's a great question. I guess my parents introduced me to the piano at a really young age, so I started piano lessons from about the age of 5 or 6. And I practiced, and all that practice paid off because as I got to high school, I then was able to move on to other instruments, and I found the drums and started playing drums with a lot of friends, and I guess found other various instruments as well, and realised that it was something that was, you know, so passionate about doing for myself, but I wanted to share that with other people and with children.
Who's your music idol?
Ooh, that's a great question. Many different people have inspired me with music. I don't think there's just one artist who I could say is an idol. Do you have a favourite artist?
Well, I love Bob Marley from reggae, and I'm into many rock bands. When did you realise that, like, homemade instruments sound like professional made?
Oh, okay.
So, like, with the thong, like, with the buckets and stuff, how did you find out they were, like,
salad drummers? That's a great question. I think trial and error, probably. So we started Beats Bus Productions just over 8 years ago, and visiting particularly kindergartens in the early days, and outside school days, care, so after school care places, and talking to kids about the drums we'd bring in, asking who had drums at home. Such a small number of children did, and we realised one of the biggest barriers to having instruments at home is the cost. Drums like these, this Junjun here, can cost upwards of $1,000. A great way to make a drum that sounds like a djembe is to take a bucket. Any size bucket will work. This is just a nice big one. Make sure it's empty. Okay, so check with mum or dad, make sure there's nothing yucky inside. Turn it upside down. You've got a bucket drum. Okay. The only problem is the bucket drum can get a little bit sore on your hand. So you get a mallet like this one from the music shop. There's lots of different types you'll be using today. When you use a mallet, try not to bend your elbow and hit the drum, but try to only use your wrist. Okay? And you hear some cool sounds like this. Okay, now, a couple of important things to know if you're going to make bucket drum kits at home. First one is different size buckets make a different sound. So the bigger the bucket, the deeper the sound. like the big daddy drum. As the buckets get smaller, the sound gets higher. So this bucket has a smaller diameter than this one, so it should have a higher sound. Let's check. This one's deeper. So if I put them together and use some rubber tip mallets, let's see what we can do. Now, the other thing you need to know about making bucket drums or a bucket drum kit at home is that sound travels through the air as vibrations, and those vibrations have to escape. So if your bucket is on the ground, you lose a lot of the bass or the low sound. You lift it up, a big difference. So that's why you might have noticed I had it up on my leg earlier on its side. And all the air and the sound is escaping out the bottom. But if you want to get creative at home, you might get some old rulers or sticks and tape them to the edge. You'd need at least three or four around, and then it could stand on the ground like a floor tom. And then you could have many drums next to each other and make your own big drum kit. Or mum or dad have a big hole saw. If you get their help, you can put a big hole on the side, and that'll also let the vibrating air escape. Now, it's not just with buckets that this happens. All drums are the same. So if I take this African djembe drum, you'll notice it's this shape, so it fits nicely between my legs. You get a beautiful bass sound. If I put it on the ground, you're gonna lose a lot of that. Okay, big difference.
Did your mum let you raid the cupboard for pots and pans?
Ooh. Didn't necessarily let me raid the cupboard. I did raid the cupboard, but I guess I had to discover early on, it was probably the neighbours complaining that made me realise, okay, hang on, if we use chopsticks, it's not as loud and offensive as a wooden spoon, say. Now I'd like to show you a percussion instrument that we call a bell. This one is in fact an African cowbell, and it works a little bit differently because the whole instrument vibrates, not just the skin or the head of the drum. So, we get two sounds. Sounds really nice. The problem with a cowbell like this, it can cost anywhere from $100 to $150 at a music shop. But if you take something which everyone has at home in the kitchen, saucepans or pots and pans, turn them upside down. Now, you might have done this when you were younger using a wooden spoon. Don't do that because neighbours from five houses away will come and complain. What we have to do is tell mum and dad you need a chopstick. Yeah, you might get one from the takeaway shop, or you might have one in the drawer already, like this one. Using the skinny end, you can get a really nice, gentle sound, just like the cowbell.
How did you learn to play all the instruments?
I guess practice and, so practice, and perseverance, you know, just sort of with all the different homemade ones is playing around and using different techniques, exploring the instrument to try to find the sweet sound or the sweet spot. You might start hitting on a giant barrel and realise it doesn't sound so nice, but then if you play on a certain area or if you use a different type of mallet, you start getting a good sound, quite a musical sound, and then you can start to put that together with other things like our bottle xylophone here or tape drums, and suddenly you've got a whole collection of instruments that work well together. And you're making your own little, I guess you can call it a junk band or recycled music, homemade instrument band. You wouldn't believe how many times I get asked, Brendan, what can you do? Some old drain pipes and a thong. Well, introducing the thongophone. So instead of throwing them in the bin, we've cut them into different lengths, we've reused them, so of course we've recycled them. Just like the drums and the buckets, the bigger the pipe, the deeper the sound. So with three lengths, I get three different sounds. And I take one of these. What's that? Thong. That's part of the name of the instrument, okay? So it's not called a xylophone. It's called a thongophone. So I hit the thong on the top of the pipe. Now all these instruments sound pretty good by themselves, but I think they'd sound even better if we put a few of them together.
One, two, three, four.
Nice job.
One,
Oh, give him a pass. Give your teachers another massive round of applause. Very nicely done.
What urge you to collect thongs?
Well, do try not to let them be too old. So, you know, but I actually don't know where I first saw the thongophone as an instrument. In fact, I think actually it could have been, I might have to give some credit to the Science Centre here in Brisbane. The Science Centre at the Queensland Museum have a great version of a thongophone that everyone can go and play.
I've been there when I was like 10, it was really cool.
Yeah, and it's all tuned properly in the two thongs.
Yeah.
I usually take over from the kids, I have to remember to let everyone else have a go. So it's an instrument which people have been used in different parts of the world and in different ways to use long pipes to make sound. But my favourite way, being Australian, wearing thongs every summer, is to use the old ones to push the air through the pipe and create that sound that we were doing earlier.
It sounds really cool.
That's a great sound, isn't it?
Yeah. I think it's time to make a drum or something. What do you think?
Absolutely. Well, I've got to get everything set up.
Stay tuned.
3, 2, 1, action.
Thanks, Laura and Brendan. Can't wait to see you more. Have you guys seen the new movie Antman? Well, it's time for our Antman movie review. Over to you, Beck.
Thanks, Alana. Hey guys, I'm Beck from Event Cinemas and I'm here to review Marvel's latest film, Ant-Man.
Imagine a soldier the size of an insect. The ultimate secret weapon.
If you give godlike powers to everyone, it's going to be chaos.
So how do we stop him?
I know a guy. Scott, I've been watching you for a while. You're different. And I believe everyone deserves a shot at redemption. Do you?
Absolutely. My days of breaking into places and stealing stuff are over. What do you want me to do?
I want you to break into a place and steal some stuff.
Makes sense.
Are you ready to become a hero?
Now, the suit has power. You have to learn how to control it. And these are your greatest allies.
You're kind of cute. Whoa.
When you're small, you have superhuman strength. You like a bullet. So you need to know how to punch.
You want to show me how to punch? Show me how to punch.
That's how you punch.
Scott Lang, played by Paul Rudd, has to embrace his inner hero and help his mentor, Dr. Hank Pym, to protect the secrets of an extraordinary suit of Ant-Man. Doesn't that suit look amazing? The Ant-Man suit gives the wearer extraordinary powers where it shrinks in size, increases its strength, and it even allows you to communicate with ants.
In the right hands, the relationship between man and the suit is symbiotic. The suit has power. The man harnesses that power.
Now dive through the keyhole, Scott. You charge big, you dive small, then you emerge big.
Ow! Ah.
Ow! Useless.
Let's have a little look at what Paul Rudd thinks about wearing the Ant-Man suit.
When you put on a costume, and certainly a costume like that, it does help with creating the character. It because you stand differently, you think differently, and especially with that, because it's like, oh, all of a sudden everything, kind of the posture changes, and I just got giddy when I first started seeing it.
As you can see, there's some pretty amazing stunts and technology used throughout this whole film.
It certainly has amazing action sequences, and some of the fights and things are just nuts. And then visually, there are things in this movie you've never seen before. I mean, there's some of the technology and what they're doing has never been done before. So I think that's going to be really striking. But the thing that really resonates with people will be, you know, what's happening with the characters and their relationships with each other.
You can become the hero and protect the world.
Shouldn't be too difficult.
The release of Ant-Man into the Marvel Universe helps to pave the way for all of our favourite superheroes to get back together again. Captain America, Thor, the Hulk, and of course Iron Man will be all in the next big film together. How exciting! Ant-Man's out in cinemas now, and I hope you love it as much as I did. I'll be along next time to review another awesome movie. So goodbye for now, and back to you, Alana.
Wow, how cool did those special effects look? Now time for Australia's favourite crafty person, Carlie Sparkle.
Hi and welcome to Carlie Sparkle Craft. Today on Juiced, we are upcycling some bottles so that you can use them for, well, whatever you want, really. I thought this one might make a nice flower vase. Aww. Okay, so these are so easy to make. All you need is a jar. Can look like whatever you want. I found this one, I thought it was an interesting shape, and some different materials. It doesn't matter. Anything you can find. I found some old paper doilies. I found this really cool tape that you can stick on, and it comes in all different patterns. Some rubber, some string, feathers, a little bit of sparkle, and these are some old comic books that I cut up that can also be a really cool way to cover your jar. You will need some glue for this and some scissors, and that's about it. All right, let's get started. All right, so I'm gonna freestyle it a bit today. I'm gonna choose things as I see them and see what comes out. That's the way that I like to work. And of course, the first thing that caught my eye is, of course, the sparkles. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna wrap this around the bottom of my jar and, all right, I've got some sneaky tape here. I'm gonna use that to stick it on. So first of all, you just need to attach it to the bottom of your jar. You can use your double-sided tape or glue, it doesn't really matter. And you just need to wrap it all the way around the jar. And I'm gonna cut this off here, like this. And I'm going to stick that on. So this is where your glue might come in handy, just to glue that very edge together so that it holds. Just like that. That will take time to dry, so don't stress if it moves around a little bit. Once it's dry, it will stay stuck. Now, the other thing that I might like to use is some sticker. Now, these are just recycled old bits of sticker that I found around the place. And I like them because they stick straight away and I don't have to use any glue. So I'm just going to place this around my jar like so. And that's falling off. That's good, isn't it? Okay. And rip it off so it's like this. I'm gonna reattach my sparkles because they have come off. It's looking pretty good so far. Next I might like to use some string. This is recycled from a very old bungee cord, and I just pull the bits off that I need and I cut them like so. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna tie it around the top. So I'm just going to tie a knot like this. And then I'm gonna wrap around my string and give it a little bit of glue just to finish it off. The glue will dry clear, so that's all right if it looks a bit messy to start with. Okay, once you've got to that point, you can put anything else that you want. I was thinking maybe I might like to use a little bit of this tape. Now, you can keep going, you can leave it like this. It's completely up to you. I want to show you some ones that I've made earlier because it really is completely up to you and your imagination what you do and what you put in your jars to make them a very cool recycled idea.
We want you to be a part of Juice TV. We're always on the lookout for hosts, interviewers, behind-the-scenes helpers, and mini-producers. You can be any age, you don't have to have any experience. How much easier could it be? To find out the next time we're filming at the hospital, just head to our website, juicedtv.com.au, or our Facebook page. For loads of fun to break up your stay in hospital, join the Juice crew. Send us an email at hello@juicetv.com.au or speak to any of the volunteers wearing green shirts throughout the hospital and let them know you want to be involved in the one and only Juice TV. Now it's time to get the lab coats out and glasses on. Professor Jellybean is back with another gooey but glittery science experiment.
We're going to make some freaky goo worms. Now, the freaky goo worms is a very cool chemical reaction experiment, and all that means is we're going to be adding one thing to another thing, and we're going to get a really neat change happening. All right, so we're going to make a very special solution, because it's just plain water at the moment, and we're going to change it into a calcium solution. So guys, we'll come and measure the special calcium powder into your water, and all you need to do is stir that one gently. Now I want you to put your dry spoon into the freaky goo. This is a common food thickener. So it's found in things like ice cream and gummy lollies. Are we gonna eat it?
No.
Definitely not. I think we need to use our sense of smell and see if we can discover maybe what the freaky goo is just by using our sense of smell. So guys, get your face close, your nose close. And brush that scent, waft that scent towards your nose. Have a bit of a smell of it. Does it smell like strawberries?
No,
it smells pretty disgusting. It is made from seaweed. That's right. Oh, we're gonna color this one with some glitter though, guys. So we're up to the really cool sciencey bit now. This is where we're going to create our chemical reaction. So all that means is we're going to add one thing to another thing, and we're going to get that really neat change that's happening, because what are we making today, guys? Freaky goo worm. Check out the worm I've made in here, guys. Here we go. Let's see how big this worm is. Still coming. I got two worms. So freaky goo worms are what you get with a very cool chemical reaction of mixing seaweed with a very special calcium solution.
It's been such a busy day with all our things. But we still got one more thing left to do, making drums with the beatbox guy.
Hey guys, we're back on Juice TV with Brendan from Beats Bus on the party deck. What are we making today?
Okay, we are gonna make one of the easiest homemade instruments to make, a tape drum, a tin and tape drum. It sounds a little bit like this. So, let's get started.
Okay.
So, what do you think we need to make a tin and tape drum, Laura?
Tin and tape.
Tin and some tape, that's exactly right. In fact, I like the way you call it a can, because that is an important part to know straight away. Make sure it's not a tin which you've actually used a can opener to cut out of, because then it's sharp and dangerous. You need to find a can which originally had a lid. So something like a Milo tin, or maybe malted milk.
Okay.
Maybe a big biscuit tin. We'll all do the job nicely. As long as it's nice and strong, then we can turn it into a drum. So, what's our next step?
I think stick tape.
Absolutely. Your creases won't hurt, and more important that it's nice and tight. Stick it down on the sides. So make your initial cross, and then I like to use a sticker. So Laura, if you've chosen some owl stickers there, if we put a sticker in the middle of the tape, and then each subsequent piece of tape that we put across our drum, thank you very much, make sure the tape travels over the top of the sticker. And that way, each piece comes through the centre of your drum. closely at the top, you'll see if you've got any gaps. I push my finger around the edge to see if there's anywhere it's weak.
Oh, yeah.
Any weak spots, because you can put as many layers as you want.
A bit like that.
Or a few more. And before we do the next step, I think we should test it. So if we take some pencils, ideally some pencils with rubber on the end. Have you got some there, Laura, to show us?
I've got two pencils.
I'll put some tape around to hold the rubber onto the pencil, because once you start beating your drum, it can come off. So, and really give it a good bounce. Okay, Laura, so our next trick is to make sure the sticky tape stays on the can and to make it look pretty. So, any ideas?
We've got some colourful tape that's very easy to use and tears easily.
Perfect, that's right. It's cloth tape or gaffer tape, and it does. It comes in bright colours. So if we take our tape, get it started. Let's turn our tins on the side. And what do you think? Should we roll the tin around, see if we can get it right around? Well, that looks pretty good with one strip, but
I think we need more colours.
I do too. Let's do it.
Let's add some more. So I might go some yellow. What colour are you going to use?
I'm going to use black.
And we are both done. The final job. Let's test them out. Grab our mallets and... Faster! One, two, three, four.
This is really fun and awesome to make.
They're easy, aren't they? It's such a simple instrument to make. And you know what? Different size tins make a different sound. So the bigger your tin, generally the deeper the sound you'll get. So I love the big Milo tin. It also matters how tightly you pull it across the top. So if you don't have big tins like this, if you take a mixing bowl from the kitchen cupboard.
Ask your parents.
Ask your parents first?
Yes.
Before we tape them up, so yes. Maybe an old mixing bowl. Now with the mixing bowl, you need to put a little bit of foam, so that's just like a kitchen sponge, which we've cut up and put the tape across the bottom. Otherwise, really rings. Then all the tape across the top. You could also use a little bucket from the garden shed. And if you do use a big tin or a bucket that has a loose bottom, if you put some tape across the bottom and a little bit of foam or paper towel folded up underneath that tape, and that'll mute the bottom and make a much nicer sound. There are some other instruments you've got sitting there. What have you got in front of you, Laura?
I've got some shakers.
Ah, okay, so how have you made those?
Well, you can recycle some bottles and you can fruit colouring and some rice and you can put some paint.
Absolutely, so you know, you can put the rice in the bottle white and then put a few drops of whichever your favourite colour is into the bottle, screw the lid back on, shake it around, colours the rice, and that actually sounds as good as a shaker you'll buy at any music shop.
If you don't have rice, you can use alternatives. So you got popcorn seeds and pasta.
Popcorn and pasta?
You can
and
steal
actually...
from the kitchen.
Pinch them from Mum's pantry, so maybe check first. But you can even get creative. You can go to the craft corner and use little beads, and that makes a different sound again. In fact, everything that you put inside will make a different sound. Trick is, don't use too much. So maybe about a fifth of the bottle in the bottom. You can even use little stones, just gravel from a bitumen driveway. It actually sounds gravelly, doesn't it?
And they make different sounds too.
Yeah, let's hear your rice shakers.
See? Pasta. Yeah.
Let's play them all together. Let's have a jam. I'll put the tape drums. You keep shaking, we'll get the tape drums.
Thank you so much for coming.
It was a pleasure. Thank you so much for having me.
No problem.
It's nearly the end of the show, but I'd like to say a big thanks to Kyle, my brother, who has been on second camera. And I'd like to say a quick thanks to all my friends in my class and in my grade.
And I'd like to thank all the nurses and doctors helping me get better.
We're back on Juice TV with Brendan from Boss Beats. Wait, Beats Boss, sorry.
Would Alana rather lick her nose or pick her toes?
Remember guys, it's so easy to be a part of Juice TV. Whether you want to be a host, help us out behind the scenes with filming, or decide what goes into each episode, let us know you want to be involved by sending an email to hello@juicetv.com.au or speak to one of the friendly volunteers throughout the hospital in the green shirts. Also head to our website and Facebook page for all the updates about what we're filming at the hospital.